Welcome to This Week in Geopolitics. My name is Jonathan Roth. I'm joined again by the chairman of Geopolitical Futures, George Friedman. George, thank you very much for joining me.
Thanks for having me.
George, it seems like we have been absolutely inundated with terrorist activity here over the last few months. We've seen a number of attacks now in France, what happened in Orlando, what happened in San Bernardino. We've seen attacks throughout the Middle East, in Saudi Arabia, of all places. It seems like terrorism is increasing in ways that maybe none of us could have imagined. You might have, however. Now, there are people, politicians, people like Marine Le Pen in France, people like Donald Trump, who are proposing some pretty, measures that no one could imagine any political figure, let alone political figures with as much support as they have, proposing things. Donald Trump's proposing, you know, a ban on Muslim immigration until things are sorted out, things along these lines. There seems to be more and more pressure maybe coming from, you know, the grassroots, from the public, saying something needs to be done. What do you think the West, you know, forecast? What do you think the West is going to do about terrorism, both in the short term and over the longer term, as we just seem to have more and more attacks happening?
Well, the way I put it is there are two parties in the West, in Europe and the United States. One party says, don't let fear get better. The other party says, something has got to be done. For the past 15 years, the party that says, don't let your fear get the better of you has been in charge. And they've argued that, look, you can't stop terrorism, and the cost of even trying would be to get rid of a range of civil liberties and fundamental things in our society. And they've had the upper hand. But the attacks haven't died down. Some of them have become more horrendous. Now, there's the other party, the party of Le Pen, the party of Donald Trump, who says, this can't go on. We have to do something radical. It becomes more and more attractive as the years go on and terrorism continues for people to side with the Trumps, with the Le Pens. And what you're seeing throughout Europe and what you're seeing in the United States is, for this and other reasons, but this reason in particular, is that the public is taking positions they wouldn't have taken 10 years ago, 5 years ago. And one of the reasons they're doing this is it's been 15 years since 9/11, and the situation has not calmed down, and don't take counsel of your fear sounds very good, but anyone who's not afraid in this circumstance is not in touch with the reality. So they're more attracted to people who claim they're going to be able to do something, and the things they're going to do may or may not be doable, but from the point of view of a lot of the public, at least they're doing something.
About a decade ago, I taped an interview with author Salman Rushdie, who he's someone that knows something about Islamic terrorism, obviously. And he told me then, he said the world is not going to de-globalize. And yet when we see some of these proposals, specifically by Donald Trump, is the world going to de-globalize given what's, you know, at least maybe temporarily, given these sorts of fears about terrorism?
Well, it's going to de-globalize among other things because of the way that Europe is economically failing. So one of the things that's driving us is terrorism. One of the other things that's driving the world is that our multinational institutions are failing. And the question is, if you're a European, as the British just said it, Europe has not, in 8 years since 2008, been able to solve the consequences of that crisis. Why should we continue to cast our lot with Europe? That's one of the things that's driving them. Indeed, for the American side, the question is, okay, we're a member of NATO with the Europeans. What are the Europeans putting on the table? What are they going to do? So you have a situation where all the sides that are part of these multinational organizations are asking the question of whether these organizations work. Add to that the fact that we're terrified of Islamic terrorism. We want to control our own borders. We want to set aside everything that can get into our countries. And you have a very powerful, potent mix of nationalism.
Following up from what you're saying there, what it sounds like to me is that to a certain extent, policymakers don't really know what to do right now. They're lost.
Well, the traditional policymakers' position has been very rational. More people die in car accidents than die in terrorist attacks. Let's live with it. they don't understand that there's a huge difference between accidents and intentional groups trying to kill you. In the recent attack in Nice, it happens that two people, a man and a small child, who live maybe 5 miles from my house, were among those who were killed. Increasingly, this personalizes the attack and makes us feel a level of urgency that we didn't have before. So we're in a situation here where we're looking for solutions. You have one side that isn't offering any. You're saying live with it. The other side is offering solutions, and many of them are preposterous. You know, when Trump says keep all Muslims out, in his mind, I think, he believes that all Muslims come from the big Middle East. Biggest Muslim country in the world is Indonesia. And they don't look at all like the people you're going to keep out. And there are millions of people in Great Britain, in Germany, and Italy, who are Muslims and have UK passports. How are you going to find out if they're Muslims or not? Or are you going to ban all the British? The problem with the party that says we got to do something is they really haven't thought through what they're going to do. There are things that could be done, and many of them may interfere with our civil liberties. And I'll make the argument that every war we have, from the Civil War to the Second World War, we intruded in the civil liberties of Americans during the course of the war. So that's a subject that we have to have, as they love to say these days, a conversation, or at least a debate. My point, however, is that the party of don't be afraid has all over Europe and the United States lost its bearings. And among other reasons, we're going to see a rise of a bunch of countries that don't play on fear, but are genuinely afraid and respect that fear.
One final question for you. Samuel Huntington, who's someone I'm sure you had some interplay with, foreign policy advisor to the Clinton administration, wrote a very famous book called The Clash of Civilizations. This idea of Islam versus the rest of the world, and particularly the West. Do you see sort of the Sam Huntington thesis playing out now over this next, decade, two, three decades? What do you, like, when you sit down and actually forecast what you see happening vis-a-vis Islam and the West, what do you think is going to happen?
Well, we have to remember that the Muslims spend as much time fighting each other as anyone else. Right. Remember that Iran is a Muslim country and a bitter enemy of Saudi Arabia. Jordanians have no particular love for the Saudis. They are badly split. So is the Christian or secular world, is whatever you want to call it now. It's badly split as well. So I don't buy Huntington's thesis about a clash of civilizations. Or I'll put it this way. Two civilizations may clash and at the same time fight out with each other or despise each other, everything else. It is not a monolithic block. So we're not facing a one monolithic Islamic world, although that's what ISIS wants to create.
Sure, sure.
What we're facing is a much more complex situation.
Subscribe for free to George Friedman's weekly column, This Week in Geopolitics, by clicking on the link in the description below. Each week you'll receive for free George's in-depth analysis of the events and forces shaping our world. Again, click on the link below to subscribe to George Friedman's free weekly column, This Week in Geopolitics.